Valerie could not be here today. The hurricane just made her have to change some of her plans. But I really want to acknowledge Kelly's work for advancing these probiotics into the field, because it's really her, as well as some of our collaborators. Again, Brian Walker and Karen Neely have been really instrumental in all of the field aspects of this work, and we really, really thank them. So what we were trying to do in going into the field is take some of these ones that we'd studied the most, that had been the most effective in aquarium assays, and move this into field testing, which was a big challenge. Like, how do you take something that's effective in a little aquarium and try to even test it in the field? So we used these bags, plastic weighted bags that would stay on the bottom, and arbitrarily kind of came up with a 2-hour deployment time. So the bags are put out, the paste is, or the probiotic is injected into the bag, so it's grown in the laboratory, centrifuged down, resuspended, and put into syringes, and then just injected under the bag. Ideally, as evenly as possible over the surface of the coral. And then a paste was also developed. This is not the CoRx paste, which is a little bit too toxic for the bacteria. So it's got sodium alginate based, and it hardens in the water, and it's non-toxic to the probiotic and the coral. So we've got three sites where we've tested Montastria cavernosa. Two in Broward, this first site, Broward site two, where we've got both the bag and the paste tested separately. And then our other two sites, we've combined the two treatments, just figuring we're gonna hit them with everything we got. And let me just show you some of the results of that. Everything has been monitored with 3D models so that we can more accurately determine, especially for the slower moving Montastria cavernosa, whether the probiotics are doing anything compared to the controls, which are treated the same way but without adding the probiotic. And so this is the first data. It's got relatively small sample size for BS2 site with MCAVs. You can see the probiotic basically stopped any disease progression. The controls continued, and there's, you know, quite a large variance in those controls. These are analyzed with general additive models, and this particular one is not significant, but there's clearly a trend there. Our second site, BS3, is a little bit more challenging, and this has actually happened to us also in the Keys, where both the control and the treatment corals didn't really progress, so we can't really say very much about what's going on with those. So let me show you the Copophila natans data. This is kind of very much in contrast to the Montastria cavernosa, where we see the treatment of the Copophila natans. Of course, Copophila natans is more susceptible, and the disease progresses more rapidly on it. So here's the CNATs. The bottom of the graph, sorry, I forgot to point that out on the previous graph, is where we actually treated them. So they were treated a couple times at the beginning, and it clearly did not halt the disease right away, but over time, the probiotic-treated CNATs did significantly better than the controls, and at the final photography time in August, all of the control corals are dead. So to summarize, we see some promise with our MCH17. It's good for the corals that the disease moves very slowly on them, but has made it a bit of a challenge to progress with some of those studies. And then our CNAT is significant and slowed the disease. And then we're continuing to do some more treatments this year and also do a direct probiotic versus antibiotic comparison, which is really challenging to do with the existing data. So let me just thank everybody again, and thank all of you for your attention. And I don't know if I have any time left.
Great, thanks, Scott. Yeah, we do have time for questions.
Yes.
Do you think there is any way to develop a type of time release mechanism for these probiotics in the same way that
they're there could be, with some kind of pellet or something you could deploy over the colony. We have not moved in that direction yet, but you know, that's done with probiotics for bees, for instance, and other things, where they put out time release kind of pellets and capsules and all sorts of things, but it's possible. What the hope was that when we treat them, these would incorporate into the microbiome of the coral, right? Because otherwise, if it's just a one-time treatment, then you're back at the same thing you are with the antibiotics, is that they're going to potentially get reinfected, right? So the idea was that, you know, that there would be some incorporation and, you know. Yeah. Yes. If I go back to that data real quick, since it's right here at the end, you know, they basically have, the ones that didn't die at the beginning, which is about half of them, did, I mean, they're not progressing at all. Yes. You know, we've tested that a bit. I didn't have time, actually quite a bit. I didn't have time to talk about it today. But they're stable for about 2 weeks in the refrigerator. So it works pretty good. Yeah. Yes. We never treated any healthy colonies.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we never did it for a prophylaxis sort of thing. We have done that in the aquaria, and that works amazingly well. Like, it prevents disease on any other corals in the tank as well. Of course, the whole tank water is being treated in the aquaria, as well as preventing transmission to colonies. Yes. Yeah, Julie Meyer, who's been collaborating with us, has been doing some of that. It's really difficult to track over time. We've been doing it with a droplet digital PCR method, and they're there, but at very low density. So they're not being retained at high levels, but they're detectable, so we think that they're in the microbiome, but not, they're not, certainly not overwhelming the